Good morning, good morning. Good morning, good morning. All right, we are happy to convene. This is the third morning. And people are coming in from different sessions. Let me tell you, we have an exciting day today. We're going to start with the United States Department of Agriculture Secretary is here. I want to talk to him about, among others, what's happening with black farmers. And then the Environmental Protection Agency. This brother's been all over dealing with, we have higher risk in our communities in terms of environmental racism. And we're going to talk about that with him. And then we're going to deal with black women's reproductive mixing. Then we have at 1 o'clock, well, I think I'm missing something. We got Michael Regan's environmental. I didn't miss that. We have at after the fireside chat, we go into DEI. And that's going to be a dynamic panel of Jamal Watson. Dr. Jamal Watson is going to lead that panel. It's going to have on it Dr. Michael Eric Dyson and Stephanie Ruhle. Many of you all watch her on MSNBC. So they're going to be on. And then Michael Regan for the Michael Regan fan club over here. And then Black Voices Online, then our international panel. And Lord Simon Woolley, who started as an activist in 1991, they killed a young man in London, England, for being in the wrong neighborhood, a black young man. And an activist named Simon Woolley asked me to come over and lead the march. It's the year we started Nash Action Network. And I led the march there, and it was just like Bensoners here. They threw bananas at us, calling us the N-word in London. I'd never been called the N-word with a British accent till then. But Simon stayed active, and the mother, the aunt of Roland Adams, who was killed, stayed active, and both of them now are in the House of Lords in England. I just was over there a month and a half ago speaking at Oxford and Cambridge. I didn't use any British accent, though I still talk the way I talk. Then we, so Woolley is going to lead that. We're going to have people on that panel talking about what's going on in Haiti, what's going on in Africa. There's a lot of international crisis, but we are not hearing about places of color. And that's why we want to have this panel and deal with that. And then, of course, our minister's luncheon, which we do every year, and Dr. Dyson's the main speaker there, as well as, at the same time, we'll be dealing with our issues here in terms of our national draft schedule. In terms of our ministers' panel on how we're going to mobilize the black church for the election. Then we're going to take 30 minutes to fill the room because then we're going to have live from the White House. He's coming down to the main room there and talk direct to the delegates here, the president, President Joe Biden, and then his head of policy has flown up so that he and I can ask him questions on what the president talked about. So we've got a pretty full, exciting day. Then Secretary of Education, Cardona, is going to be here. We're going to talk with him. And then the young people are going to have a session on building safer community. Then we're going to deal with black health. And so it's a full day. I know some of y'all are just recovering from dancing with me last night. Your knees all right? I know I put a little on you. How many of you enjoyed the conference so far? I would thank you for y'all being here, and as people come in, again, do not leave and then want to have your seat that you got. Stay in your seat or get somebody to hold it, because a lot of people going to want to hear this or that, DEI or the president, but I want those that are the real foot soldiers of National Action Network to hear what's going on. And the people come in and want to barge in. No. This is about having the right discussion so we have the right information to organize from. So we're going to get started. Let me start with the secretary, with a fireside chat with the Secretary of Agriculture. Let's welcome up Secretary Vilsack, will be joining me. Well, good morning, Secretary Vilsack.
I got to tell you, Reverend, I'm a little nervous about this.
I got to tell you, I'm in the business of keeping people nervous.
Yeah, I know.
So don't worry.
I know. But I'm nervous because I have such a profound respect for the work that you've done, and I'm a little bit awestruck. So,
but thank you.
Let me sort of get comfortable here.
All right, well, let me say, Secretary Vilsack was confirmed in February of 2021, the 32nd U.S. Agricultural Secretary. He returned to the role that he previously filled for 8 years, having been the longest serving member of President Obama's original cabinet. Longest serving member. And many of you know he served prior to that as governor in Iowa for 2 terms, and he served in the Iowa State Senate and for mayor of Mount Pleasant, Iowa. And I welcome him, and I thank him for coming. Let me start with, what are some of the things that we're seeing differently done in the agricultural department now, you, in light of the fact that you are one of the longest serving cabinet members and having served the same position as Secretary of Agriculture, in between the time you were there and the 4 years you weren't under the Trump administration, what have you seen that you had to change that might have happened under the past administration?
Well, first of all, we had to make sure that the leadership of USDA reflected the diversity of the country we're serving. So for the first time in the history of the department, we had an African-American woman being the deputy. We had, for the first time, an African-American man being in charge of our conservation programs, our Forest Service, rural development, opportunities for, first time, our chief scientist in charge of all of our research programs, African-American woman. Opportunity for the Department of Administration that operates the day-to-day backroom operations, African-American man. So we basically diversified the workforce. Then secondly, we began to do a very deep dive into the past of USDA. We all know that it has had a past of discrimination against people of color across the board, not just in farming, but across the board in rural places. So we commissioned an equity commission. We wanted an outside look. We got some critical thinkers. Delivering to you today the report of that equity commission, as well as the report from us to the equity commission of the recommendations that they've made. Nearly 60% of them have already been acted upon by the department. And we also did an internal review. We had each mission area look at itself and ask the question, what could we do to incorporate day-to-day, everyday equity. And they came up with a series of equity plans. That's also included in these packets of information. So I'm going to give it to you. Now, I know you're not necessarily going to read all this, Reverend, but somebody in your...
Don't bet on it now. Don't bet on it.
But, it's,
but thank you.
I think it reflects a genuine concern and desire for the department to incorporate into the DNA of the department the notion that diversity, equity, inclusion, accessibility is something that benefits the department and benefits the people we serve. We're strongly committed to it, and you'll see in the questioning that we've incorporated.
Now, let me ask you, as you give me this equity report, one of the concerns at National Action Network has been around diversity, equity, and inclusion, and the battle that, frankly, Bill Ackman and Stephen Miller and others have launched to end DEI. How much have you had to deal with their legal attacks around equity in the Department of Agriculture?
Virtually every day.
Really?
Every day. I'll give you a couple of examples. Congress passed the American Rescue Plan, and in the American Rescue Plan, there were resources provided to the department to essentially satisfy the debt obligations of black farmers as a reflection of the need to give them an opportunity to get a step up. We began to institute that program, and we got a bit down the road, and all of a sudden we were hit with not one, not two, but 13 separate lawsuits in which federal judges enjoined, stopped us from implementing that program. As a result of those lawsuits.
So wait a minute, based on the same DEI opponents, you had faced 13 lawsuits and the court stopped you from forgiving the debt of black farmers.
13 times, and all over the country. They were in Wyoming, they were in Texas, they were all over the country these lawsuits were filed. So that lingered for quite some time. The Congress comes in and says, okay, we'll do away with that plan. We'll develop a different plan in the Inflation Reduction Act. We'll take the $5 billion that we had provided you, and we'll now tell you at USDA, use $3 billion of it to reduce debt, if you can, $2 billion to essentially provide assistance for anyone who experienced discrimination. So we've been able to institute that program without interference. But then, in the meantime, we had a disaster assistance program that was providing assistance and help. And we used the notion that folks who've been underserved, folks who are small and mid-sized farming operations may not get as much protection from crop insurance and things like that. So we tried to structure the disaster program in a way that would provide assistance. Again, lawsuits now filed. We'll be arguing a temporary injunction request on the part of folks in Texas to stop that effort. So it's ongoing, and I would say a couple of things. First of all, we can't let this happen. We can't let this happen. For all the reasons for why all the people who are in this audience and what you've dedicated your life to, but also at the end of the day, we are a much, much better department. When we embrace DEIA, we have more creative problem solving. We have people whose points of view, whose life experiences are different. They come in, they look at problems differently, they solve problems differently. You get many more creative ideas out of a population like that than you do if you have. So it's important to the department, it's important to rural America, because the fact is, rural America is diverse.
And to forgive the debt, as you had, until you were stopped by these right-wing lawsuits and the courts, to forgive the debts of black farmers is also so they can build more and bigger farms, which helps the country.
That's right. It gives them an opportunity. I mean, the reality is, because of the discrimination, black farmers were not able to expand their operation in the 50s and 60s and 70s.
Right.
In many cases, they weren't able to keep their operation.
Exactly.
They lost the farm. And what we're trying to do now is give them the opportunity not only to continue farming, but to do it in a way that can be successful for themselves and families.
And in the 50s, 60s, 70s on, they couldn't get the bank loans, they couldn't get the financing. And that's why they got into debt. They were not in debt because they were irresponsible.
No, that's right. And what's interesting, the games that were played, sometimes they did get the loan, Reverend, but they got it late in the planting season.
Right.
So the white farmer down the road got his loan on time, so he was able to buy all the inputs, get the crop in the ground early, big crop, nice crop, successful crop. Black farmer, later in the growing season, not as much of a yield, not as much income. So when land became available down the road, who was in a better position to be able to purchase that additional farmland, obviously. So it takes time, it takes commitment, it takes effort to begin the process of giving people a chance to do what they love to do. Here's what I know about farmers, black, white, whatever. They love to farm and they want to pass it on to the next generation.
Right.
And it's our job to make sure that that happens.
Climate change. I know you've had to deal with the issues of climate change. Give us what is the department doing to deal with climate change as a reality today?
Well, I like to look at this, and it's a problem because it's going to impact and affect what's grown, how much is grown. It's going to impact not only agriculture here in the United States, but also globally. The question is, can we take this problem, this challenge, and create an opportunity out of it? And I think we've figured out a way to do that. We basically took $3 billion of resource at the USDA, and we put it on the table, and we said to American agriculture, what would you do with it? And they said, come back with a volunteer, market-driven incentive program, and we will embrace climate smart practices, create a market incentive for us to be able to sell those crops. We said, fine, but one condition. We want to make sure that as you put these opportunities together, you incorporate historically underserved producers, that you don't just let one or two big farmers, size farmers, get the benefit of this. We want to make sure you incorporate. And then secondly, we want to make sure that you also hold yourself accountable so that we have universities, including historic black colleges and universities, minority-serving institutions, helping these farmers keep track of what they're doing. So what we have now, Reverend, in every single state, over 100 commodities, 203 climate smart practices, we're paying farmers, including historically underserved farmers, to embrace those practices, and we're creating market incentives. So let me give you an example. We have rice that's now being produced by farmers in Arkansas and Louisiana, including black farmers, that uses a new way of producing the rice that reduces methane by 50% and water usage by 50%. Mm. They got paid to do that, and they got paid a premium from the market, and this is the first commercially scaled product that's going to be resulting from these efforts. So we're helping incent the right behavior, we're helping the market reward the right behavior, and we're ensuring that every farmer can participate. Now, the last thing I would say about this, I'm really passionate about this, so I get kind of worried.
No, go ahead.
I get wound up about this. When you measure something, you can sell it. So if you measure the carbon that's being sequestered or you measure the greenhouse gas reduction, there's some entity or business out there that needs that offset. So farmers will be paid for that offset. So now it's a new stream of income in addition to the commodity. Part of these programs also take agricultural waste where we have been over-applying it on land, creating serious water problems. It will redirect that waste into the development of new bio-based products, moving away from our reliance on fossil fuel-based products. So now there's two additional revenue streams coming into farms in addition to the selling of a commodity. And finally, we incorporate renewable energy into all of this as well, so farmers not only reduce their costs, reduce the greenhouse gas impact of whatever they're growing, but they're going to be producing excess energy, and they may be able to sell that excess energy on the grid. So now instead of one commodity that they sell for next to nothing, they now have four different opportunities to earn income, and maybe that's a way we can have more small and mid-sized farmers be able to stay on the land.
Let me ask you this. Do you think it is important for young people to get more into farming and dealing with the agricultural needs of the country?
It is. The challenge, of course, is how do you, as a young person who has very little income or doesn't inherit a farm, how do you get that? How do you get that opportunity? We have a beginning farmer rancher program designed to provide help and assistance. We have loan programs, microloan programs, and other insurance products that are designed for small, very, very small operations to get people started. Here's why this is important. If you're a young person, if you can go into an FSA office or you can go online, you can get a microloan, $50,000 loan, 7-year payout, low interest rate. It gives you the ability to create enough experience with farming that you can then qualify for the larger loans that the Department of Agriculture has for operation and ownership. So encouraging young people to use these microloan programs and the Beginning Farmer and Rancher program. We're also working with a number of entities to create more market opportunities, more local and regional food market opportunities. We have, for example, a local purchasing agreement in every state where as we buy food for schools or for food banks, a portion of that is going to be purchased from local producers. So we're creating markets, we're creating access to credit, we're providing the research and the knowledge in an effort to try to get more people engaged in this business.
Let me ask you, is Reverend Byrd, Malcolm Byrd, step out here a minute. This is the, our chief of operations now. And he just, that's Reverend Malcolm Byrd, he also pastors Mother AME Zion in Harlem. He just passed me a note, why am I talking about farming? We're going over time. See, he was born and raised in Long Island. And he doesn't understand, Mr. Secretary. Hey. My mother was born and raised in Dothan, Alabama. They farm down there. He don't know everything they eat in the suburbs of Long Island came from a farm.
Can I also tell?
Yeah.
The Department of Agriculture just invested $835 million in an urban forestry initiative involving not only the planting of trees in areas that have been socially disadvantaged and challenged so that you improve neighborhoods, but also creating workforce opportunities for young folks. And we've been working with black churches.
Yeah, working with black churches.
Yeah.
So you go sit in the corner, put on a dunce hat till we finish. Let me say, wrapping up, what do you hope your legacy in this term now will be in terms of farming, in terms of the Department of Agriculture?
My hope is that every farmer understands that they're honored, they're respected, and that the department is available to them. And I hope that the department itself incorporates into its very fabric the notion of the importance of diversity, equity, inclusion, and accessibility now and forever. And that we basically put a stop to the past and that we create a much, much better and more responsive Department of Agriculture.
Well, thank you for being here. Thank you. Give him a hand. Let's bring out the DEI panel. He certainly set that up. Let me say, I think that it was good that the Secretary of Agriculture said they're going to fight to keep DEI. And when many of you that have been with us now 13 weeks marching on Bill Ackman on every Thursday, and many of you that were trying to understand why I was trying to make this such a big issue, you heard him say this. He heads the Department of Agriculture now, USDA. You heard him say that they were getting ready to forgive the debt of black farmers, and they got slammed with lawsuits and got an injunction against them forgiving the debt. A lot of us, you know, we do the rah-rah and don't do the research. And that's why this is important to bring the people with the, that's in the middle of it. And I was glad him to say they gonna keep fighting. And he mentioned DEI by name. So I'm very happy about having Secretary Vilsack here. That goes along with, you know, what do folks do? He told you what happened under the Trump administration. And everybody running around talking about what old men could do. Old men could forgive farm debts if we keep fighting. Our next panel deals specifically with the question of DEI and its ramifications. We're going to stay right there. We have on the panel from the, he's the new president of the Center for Political and Economic Studies, the Joint Center, we call it. And many of you that's been in there in a while may remember about maybe 20 years ago, he was our field director here at Nash Action Network. He's a NAN baby. And he was there when I was running for president. He was there when I went to Cuba. And he's got one of the unique experiences in life where he was there when Fidel Castro and I had lunch. And Fidel Castro was telling me what the count was in Florida in 2000. And I felt that was the strangest thing in the world. I'm having the president of Cuba telling me how Gore and Bush's count was. And Diedrich was there at the table. So he had a lot of experiences with us, and we're glad to have us. When Dr. Watson asked me, is it all right to have Diedrich Muhammad? I said, you ought to be asking Diedrich, is it all right for you to come? Because Diedrich is a NAN baby. Give a hand, Diedrich Muhammad. Next to him is the queen herself. All of this debate about critical race theory started with the actions, academic heroism, and the stand up as a real queen and giant should and would of Professor Kimberly Crenshaw. And we go way back, but let me tell you, the things that she's had to endure for standing up and defining what critical race theory was, defining what DEI was, from death threats to threats in her career, and she's a professor at UCLA and Columbia. She's bi-coastal, but she's stood strong and she has been firm, and we're proud that she would break in her schedule and come and be with us today. Give another hand, Professor Kimberly Crenshaw. Next to her is my sister. I mean, we are sisters and brothers, a real, you talking about something, what y'all that watched the 11th hour, you already know. You know, at MSNBC, I did Morning Joe this morning, you know, they give a lot of hosts the teleprompter. They give her a blank screen because she going to just say what she want to say. They don't put nothing up. They know that Stephanie going to just run with Stephanie. And that's why she has the audience she has. And I'm so honored that she would come spend time with Nash Action Network. Give a hand, Stephanie Ruhle. And then I've been very much involved in reading and studying some of the work of Alvin Tillery, Dr. Alvin Tillery, who is very deep. I try to act erudite and intelligent when I'm talking to him. Drop all my Brooklyn stuff. But he is a PhD director of the Center of Study of Diversity and Democracy at Northwestern University. Give a hand, Dr. Tillery. And last but not least, I call him the Socrates of our time. But let me tell you, there's no one that has been, in my judgment, more on the cutting edge of thought in this country, black and white, and has done it heroically with his books, with his advocacy, and just for the last two or three decades, he has been a preeminent thinker from our community and writer. And he's a preacher. He's going to preach at our minister's luncheon today. And he is an activist. I get so sick of these ivory tower black thinkers that talk for us that never talk to us. And I figured out why, Kimberly, they don't talk to us is because they don't know how to communicate in our language. So they go up in the ivory tower and impress their bosses on how smart they are by talking to their bosses in their language. And the boss said, oh, they're bright, rather than talking to us down to earth, because they never come down to earth. They impersonate what they think we about rather than inform us what we about. He is the opposite of that. I'm talking about our man, Dr. Michael Eric Dyson. Let me bring on our convener, our panelists, and let me say this. You got to be real sharp, because, you know, I come out of a civil rights family, and the brightest one of the families in the audience is going to critique you. Stand up, Jesse Jackson Jr. is in the house. Okay. Jesse's book on the one on Constitution. Is now you need four interpreters to read that book. Because I never understood that how deep this thing was in terms of constitutional law. So I want y'all to know that he's gonna explain to me what y'all said and what y'all didn't say that didn't make sense. But this brother is someone that I know well. He's now a professor at Trinity Washington University. He's the executive editor of Diverse Issues of Higher Education. He's been around Nash Action Network for about 20, 25 years, and he walks the walk and talks the talk. He will moderate this panel, Dr. Jamal Watson.
Good afternoon. You all can do better. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Oh, wonderful. Thank you so much for... Oh, morning. Okay, I'm sorry. It's morning. I got ahead of myself. It's morning. Thank you for the correction there. I love the call and the response because you all corrected me right away. So thank you. But we have a real serious discussion to talk about, and that is the tax on DEI. We see states, legislatures around the country beginning to attack DEI, both in higher education and also the corporate sector. And what we're going to do this morning is we're going to dissect and talk about what is happening and how we can begin to push back. So I want to start off right away and get into it and ask, sort of, how do you all assess, panelists, where we are right now as it relates to the attacks on DEI? And I want to start with Diedrich.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. It's great to be back here at National Action Network. I think the first thing we need to recognize, I mean, it's clearly an all-out attack happening, and it's an all-out and effective attack, right? I mean, we heard a little bit what's happening with the Department of Agriculture. Just a month or so ago, there's some ruling by a judge about how the Commerce Department for Minority Business Development Agency can no longer just serve or focus on minorities, and that it has to be much bigger, which means much more likely that the minority entrepreneurs will continue to be left behind. And I was looking at the some of the t-shirts, and it was saying, we won't go back. And I think, you know, what we have to, I'm gonna add an addendum to that, and we must go forward, and we must go forward more rapidly, right? So they oftentimes say in sports, the best defense is a strong offense, and we have to be much more offensive. At Joint Center for Political Economic Studies, Black Think Tank, for the last 54 years, we have been pushing for to ensure greater diversity for top staff in congressional offices. And an early victory in 2020, they created a House Office of Diversity and Inclusion. And if y'all remember, just a couple months ago, there was always concern about will the federal government be shut down because they can't get an agreement on the budget. What they did is they slipped into the bill something that would then close the House Office of Diversity and Inclusion. So we got the government open, but we shut down the House Office of Diversity and Inclusion. And, you know, we at Joint Center, you know, want to make sure everyone understands that and how we're fighting that and how we're going to make sure we work with the Office of Management to ensure that some of the diversity numbers that we've been analyzing, and we have Dr. LaShonda Brown, who's going to be putting out a new report looking at top Senate staff about what the diversity is there. So it's been an effective attack. We have to realize that. We have to be more effective and make sure we don't go back, but that you also go forward quickly.
Thank you so much. Professor Tillery, can you weigh in on this?
So first I want to say it's great to be here. I want to thank Reverend Sharpton for the invite. Thank you for inviting me to be on this panel. So I think what we need to step back and realize is that the attacks on DEI are really part of a broader strategy, a political strategy by the Republican Party and the Trump administration, or the Trump campaign to overturn the Civil Rights Act of 1964. And you know, while we're wringing our hands and debating about what happens at Harvard and all, I mean, I went to Harvard, fine. 95% of black students in America go to schools that never used affirmative action in the first place, right? So what they're doing is they're getting us caught up in this process argument when their aims are really to reconstitute the racial order, Jim Crow. And we need to wake up to that and to know that most of this is a reaction to what happened in 2020 with the George Floyd protests. A lot of powerful, well-heeled people in the ruling classes saw their kids and grandkids out in the street in multiracial protests to demand police accountability. And so the Republicans, starting with Mr. Trump, said one way to push back on that is to ban, you know, DEI training, right? Equity is not optional, people. Equity is enshrined in the 14th Amendment, and it's operationalized through the Civil Rights Act. So what they're doing with these attacks is trying to soften up the consciousness of the citizenry, particularly white folks, to think it's okay to ban equity. And so we're in the fight of our lives here with this election. We need to wake up and realize that and start talking about the fact that DEI programs started in corporate America and colleges because of lawsuits, because people were suing institutions that were not integrating. We need to go back to our roots and realize that we do have the power to push back against this now. But have you written to any Democratic politicians in your blue state legislatures and said, what's your legislative response to the red state's response of banning Professor Crenshaw's work? How many people have done that? Have you called your Democratic congressman, 40, 50 black members of the Congressional Black Caucus, have you written to them and said, what is your plan for if Mr. Trump comes in, and he stated explicitly on day one, he's gonna ban the use of EEO1 data. So what that's gonna do is it's going to kill the Civil Rights Act, just the way killing Section 5 preclearance of the Voting Rights Act made it inoperable. So we need to wake up. All this critique of wokeness, we're not woke enough.
Yes, sir.
We need to wake up right now and use our political power to make sure that we can be ready for the worst case scenario. And then if the worst case scenario doesn't happen, we need the politicians that claim to represent us to do more right now. So I'll stop there.
Thank you so much. Professor Crenshaw.
Yes, sir. Well, I'm just gonna pick up where my co-panelists left off. One of the things we have to recognize is that this is not just an attack on a policy, it's an attack on a people, and that people would be us. They have made it clear for the last decade that they're going to try to reverse not only the generational election of Barack Obama and the exercise of black power, but they're trying to erase the entire apparatus of the civil rights movement. They want the whole thing. So how do you go about trying to erase 60 years of laws, legislation, policy, practices that are responsible for us being able to integrate the institutions to the limited extent that we are? Let's be clear, we're still underrepresented everywhere, except in prison, right? Those are the only place we're not underrepresented. So how do you go about it? First of all, you cut up our legacy into bits and pieces, and you go after that. So first you go after the Voting Rights Act, right? You eliminate our political power to protect ourselves, and you rely on the fact that there's a fifth vote on that Supreme Court that looks like us and made it possible to gut the most significant piece of civil rights legislation that we ever created. Then you go after the actual story, the history, our capacity to name our experience, because guess what? When you can't name an experience, you can't transform it. So when Trump signed that executive order and went after EEOC policies, diversity, affirmative action, critical race theory, 1619, implicit bias, he was coming after everything that we have accomplished. Now here's the problem. The problem is, partly because it was all separated, partly because we don't really know our history, partly because we don't know what critical race theory is, a lot of people didn't see this as something that we needed to get our resource together with and address. So let me tell you, I would call up people like, what we gonna do? And people would say, what you mean we? I'm like, wait, they're coming after racial justice ideas, they're coming after our practices and our policies. A lot of people didn't see it coming. So just to be clear that we all know what they're going after when they go after our ideas, if you are a person who gives your child the talk so they can survive an encounter with police, you are practicing critical race theory. You are critical about the reality that race is going to make a difference in his or her life. That's what critical race theory is all about. So when they're coming after our ideas, they're coming after us. Diversity, equity, and inclusion was coming next. And that's exactly what happened. So here's what I think we need to be aware of. They're not going to stop until they achieve in this Reconstruction what they did in the last Reconstruction. This is all about redemption, 2024. And if you have any doubt about what they're trying to do, look at Project 2025, the Heritage Foundation. They are clear about it. They want to take away the power of the EEOC. You heard that? They want to take away a power to even collect data. We can't make a claim of discrimination if we can't collect the data. So they're going to the core of our capacity to fight and survive. That only means that we have to be there everywhere they are. We've got to contest Heritage Foundation, we've got to contest the GOP, we've got to contest Make America Great Again, because America was never great for us and we ain't trying to go back there. And lastly, we've got to make our own elected officials responsible. They're the quickest ones to say, oh, we can't talk about diversity anymore. They're giving up these programs because of this civil rights case that has nothing to do with many of the institutions that say we ain't going to do DEI anymore. 60 employees, DEI from Florida, were fired. Over 100 were fired in Texas. We should be fired up about that because they are trying to fire us across America, and we are not going to go back.
Thank you so much, Professor Crenshaw. Ms. Rule?
I think one of the biggest problems is misinformation and disinformation, that everyday Americans don't even know what the truth is. So Professor Crenshaw can't even get to the table to teach critical race theory because she's starting from behind zero, because there's already an avalanche of misinformation coming that you have to fight every day. And one of the big issues around DEI is that people simply don't understand. Okay, so when you think back to the financial crisis and all the banks that punished people, all the businesses that went under, did anyone say, well, all those institutions are run by white guys? No one said that. But when an institution fails, when a business leader fails, and they're a person of color, it's immediate, well, they were a DEI candidate. Last week when the bridge collapsed in Baltimore, you saw in right-wing media the mayor of Baltimore being referred to as a DEI mayor, not a mayor of Baltimore, a diverse city. And every time you hear those things, we collectively hear those things, we have to stop them. Because one of the problems is DEI has become weaponized And people hear about it all the time, but it actually hasn't had that much success, right?
Right.
On the street, you would think, my God, black women are taking over corporate America. They're not. There are more white guys named John and Steve running Fortune 500 companies than there are female black CEOs in total.
Yes, ma'am.
And this notion that white children, white teenagers cannot get into top universities because diversity candidates are, is also a flat-out lie. Your son isn't getting into Vanderbilt because he smokes pot in your garage and plays PlayStation all day. And so what Professor Crenshaw is talking about are these big macro levels, but on a micro level, day in and day out, we have to stop these lies because these lies continue and they get into the zeitgeist of America. And that's what it ends up in suburban America of the, oh my gosh, diversity's just taken over the world. It's not. It's absolutely not. So what we have to start is to come from a place of truth and realize those who are attacking DEI are not playing fairly. They're playing dirty. And I'm not saying you have to fight dirty with dirty, but open your eyes and bring a weapon to the fight.
That's right. All right. Professor Dyson.
I teach at Vanderbilt. Where those white boys with the weed? I want to take it away from them and put it to greater use. Look, look, we know what the deal is, right? We know DEI. Now, I done seen this on the internet where DEI is the new N-word. That's what it is, right? DEI, BLM, BHM, MLK, NBA, NFL. Right? Any place that is identified with black excellence against the historic onslaught of white mediocrity. DEI is dangerous because it exposes Bubba already been DEI'd from the very beginning. And diversity to a dominant culture could be you from Maine and I'm from Alabama. Right? So we know that diversity, equity, inclusion, and accessibility, they forget to add to A all the time. The truth is that this is an ongoing project from reparations, don't want that. Affirmative action, don't want that. DEI is what y'all said, y'all wanted in place of real justice. So y'all now find that offensive. And as Ms. Rule and Professor Crenshaw and Brother Diedrich and Brother Tillery said, Dr. Tillery, the thing is that we know that white brothers and sisters have already been advantaged and benefited from the very thing they want now to deny us, claiming that we are incapable and unable to occupy these spaces. And we know already, one of the great things about Donald Trump, he kills the argument of white superiority just by speaking. Just by showing up, we know, oh damn, he is the walking fleshly deconstruction of white supremacy, white superiority, and white intelligibility. God knows literacy is off the table. So we have to, as Professor Crenshaw said, they were coming, we thought, oh, that's the DEI, you know, that's critical race theory, that's not us. It's all us. They're going to DEI you at the end of the day. They're going to CRT you at the end of the day. So we all got flesh in this game. We all got skin in this game. So what do we have to do? First of all, we have to identify with the fact that arguing for DEI, as some have argued, is not about bullcrap and so on and so forth. What it is about insisting that we have our seat at the table. Number two, DEI and the other forms of racial justice, it's just the floor, it's not the ceiling.
Right.
Number three, Martin Luther King Jr. said in his book in 1963, Why We Can't Wait, if the nation has done something special against the Negro for 250 years, the nation got to do something special for the Negro for 250 years. Number five, we know that the greatest beneficiaries of this are white women, right? even if the white women are fronting for white men who argue against DEI while taking money under the table, right? Now, I'm not dissing white women. Thank God Stephanie's got rules, right? The thing is that we understand this is a red herring. As Professor Tillery said, they going after the whole kit and caboodle. They denied Small Business Administration now being able to give money to African-American people. Now it's got to be opened up to white folk and other folk. They want all of it. After Reconstruction, the only people who got reparation for slavery were white slave owners because they lost their help. So what you got to understand is we all in the same game. Let's support each other. Let's articulate the principles and practices that need to be put in place. Let's listen to the so-called egghead scholars, because we're going to break them eggs, scramble them, and make sure y'all get fed. That's what we're trying to do.
Thank you, Dr. Dyson. Earlier in the intro, Reverend Sharpton mentioned the protests that have been taking place by National Action Network every week, every Thursday, against Bill Ackman. One of the things that I think is really important is that we make the connection between the corporate and higher education. Mm-hmm. So, Professor Tillery, I wanted to ask you, how do we do that? Because it's not just higher ed that's under attack, but it's these corporate spaces as well. And how can we organize a response like National Action Network has been doing consistently now every single week to keep that momentum going?
Yeah, it's a great question. So, you know, I'm an academic, but I also have a lot of engagements in the world of business. I build an executive education program on diversity, equity, and inclusion. We've trained about 9 or 10,000 people since 2019 in corporate America, mostly Fortune 500s. I also teach executive ed at the Kellogg School of Business, and I run a polling firm called 2040. Strategy group. It's all under this vertical. So I kind of come at this from a multifocal lens. And you know what's clear, the affirmative action case against Harvard, because again, 95% of black students in college in America do not go to the 100 colleges that practiced race-based affirmative action, right? So just wrap your mind around that. So what was that lawsuit about? It was about a court which is packed with people that are there to serve the will of the right-wing interests that Professor Crenshaw has pointed out want to put us all back into a condition of Jim Crow, right? They did that, they broke the Harvard admissions program so that they could then go around and challenge all of these corporate programs, right? And so if you have nothing to think about affirmative action, what you do need to realize is that they just did that to get the principle that they could use to break everything else in place, right? And so when you look at the corporate response, I was talking to Stephanie and others about beforehand, like I've worked with 70 companies since 2020, right? Mostly in the Fortune 500s, and they're all in a pincer right now, right? The biggest companies want, they're afraid of their workers, which is why I largely got hired to work with them for the first place, right? After George Floyd, there was all this pressure to finally address, you know, racial inequality. And people like those programs, right? The polling shows that most Americans like their corporate DEI programs. Like 77% of white people like their corporate DEI training, right? So the CEOs of these companies are in a tight position. They're getting sued by Stephen Miller and the same people that broke affirmative action, Ed Blum, but their workers are like, are you giving up? So they're feeling pressure. So the best thing that we could do to help out these CEOs, some of them don't want to do this work, right? But they feel pressured to do it internally. The best thing we could do is demand from them an accounting. Before you buy from one of these companies, figure out, are they in the media? Are they on Stephanie's shows being reported as backing away from all these initiatives, right? Hold your dollars back, right? You know, when you are living in a place like New York City and you're asking about what can be done, well, you know, who's managing the capital of the pension funds in New York City, right? Make sure that your black elected officials and your white progressive officials know that you expect the people doing business with this city, with the state of New York, to not be backing away right now, right? And that's the way it won't solve the corporate issue. The corporate issue's never been perfect. We got the phrasing DEI, as Professor Dyson said, because that was a soft pedal on racial justice in the first place. The programs are not fully effective, but they're better than nothing, right? And so what we've got to do is keep the pressure on in any way we can, with protests, with voting, holding our dollars back, and demanding that these people be accountable.
Yeah, thank you.
You also have to realize that your average Fortune 500 CEO out there is neither good nor bad. They're not immoral. They're not doing the right thing. They're amoral. A CEO's job is to be a risk manager. And I'm going to say he because chances are it's a he. He is looking to pay his employees the lowest number he can pay them to ensure that they won't quit. He wants to sell the best products to the most amount of people. And he wants the world to be quiet, and he wants their share prices to go up. So once you know that this is how this business leader is being judged, then you can start to play ball. And I'm not saying that's fair. I'm not saying that it feels good. No. But sometimes you can't be so idealistic demanding something from someone that has a different set of rules, because he's not being judged. He's not being measured on that. So you have to, in some levels, meet them where they are, that we want these companies to work with us. We want them to do the right thing. But vilifying them 24/7 is a gift to them, because it's only going to make them shy away from this and saying, this is too loud, I want to hide. We got to find ways to work with them in constructive ways. They understand who their customers are, and they understand who the next generation of the workforce is, and they have to embrace diversity.
Professor Crenshaw, you wanted to jump in?
So I want to build on both of these points, because ultimately what we have to do is change the equation on the ground so there is risk in them backing away from DEI. So the problem right now is that from that risk management perspective, the only thing they're hearing, the only images they see, the only parents who are pissed off, the only employees and the only foundations that are whispering in their ear are the ones who want to get rid of DEI. Right? Or the ones at the school board level who want to get rid of critical race theory, or the ones who want to get rid of black studies. So it means that we need to be making the noise so they at least have to consider that I might get in equal trouble, if not more, if I actually go along with the Christopher Rufos in the world, if I actually go along with the Heritage Foundation. But we have to be willing to fight, and that is the challenge, because look, we wouldn't have been in this situation, even after the Civil War, if our allies hadn't decided, you know what, we're done with this. We're tired of it. We want to make up. We don't want to have this conflict anymore. So they threw Reconstruction under the table. They threw black people under the table. And for 70 years, we were a powerless people because our allies did not show up for us. Now we've got to look to see, are our allies repeating the same thing? And I want to submit that unless we put pressure on our allies, they will not show up for us again. Case in point, when the College Board decided to take out letter from the Birmingham Jail, Audre Lorde, critical race theory, intersectionality, Black Lives Matter from a course that was made possible because of the George Floyd protests. They were never able to get that course mounted until people were in the streets in every state of the union demanding accountability, using the language of structural racism, talking about implicit bias. So they saw this as an opportunity to create this course, but then they ran into the DeSantis buzzsaw, who basically said, no, you ain't coming up here teaching a course about this stuff. You got to take all of these things out of it. And the College Board bent the knee. Why? Because there was more money to be made by trying to sell the course to Florida and Texas than standing their ground. But here's the thing. They don't always do that because they know there's going to be responses. They didn't take evolution out of the science courses just because the Christian right wanted them to. They didn't take gender out of the psychology course just because the right wing wanted them to. So they're taking race and our stuff out is possible because they don't think there are going to be any consequences to it. So we've got to create those consequences. I remember Adam Clayton Powell said this one thing. It was during the Kress sit-ins in the 60s. And the question was, you are suggesting to all Negroes not to go to Kress, to boycott Kress. And he said, no, that's not right. I'm suggesting all Americans everywhere, not just in the South, everywhere, boycott Kress and any other company that is operating a segregated lunch counter in South, even if they're not doing it in the North, because it's all connected. They need to feel the pressure everywhere. So if we want to break down educational apartheid, if we want to make sure that our kids in Florida learn the same thing as our kids right here in Harlem, then we've got to put pressure on all of those appeasers who are actually facilitating this. That's the only way we change the equation on the ground.
All right, thank you so much, Mr. Asante Muhammad.
And just to build on these previous points, you know, I mean, we have to be as extreme in our, I guess we have to be more extreme in our demand for justice as they're being extreme in their demands for injustice. Stephen Miller, a former aide of Trump, started organization America First, and they are filing lawsuits everywhere, even private, public sector. They're trying to end the Rooney Rule, or they tried to end the Rooney Rule, and the NFL would just mean you had to interview a few minority candidates for head coaching jobs. I did a report this past fall with Institute for Policy Studies, Still a Dream, 60 years after the March on Washington for Freedom and Jobs, and it noted that we've made some progress from the 1960s to today, but in terms of income inequality, it would take another 500 years at the rate of progress we've made in the last 60 years. So we have to be, we can't be like, oh, they're attacking us now. As has been stated, they've been attacking us. They've been holding us back, and they're now going for the most mild manner of reforms possible in diversity and inclusion. So we can't just be moderate and say, oh, we want that back. We have to say, no, what's getting on the path to move us forward so in the next generation we're going to get what we've all been fighting for and our ancestors have been fighting for?
Can I respond to that?
Okay. Dr. Dyson.
Yes, sir. I mean, everything, I amplify everything everybody said. We need to be Starsky and Hutch, right? We need some people out there shouting, acting crazy. Then the inside Negroes, oh my God, I can't believe the incivility of those Negroes. But they do have a point. And if you don't want them burning this shit down, you should listen to us because we have some asbestos for you. The thing is, we not always understood that, right? Because black intelligence has never impressed white mediocrity. W.E.B. Du Bois thought, we can prove to them that we are superior. We can prove to them that we are good Negroes. Martin Luther King Jr. got murdered in a suit.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Come on.
He wasn't dressed down.
Come on.
With sagging pants. His high intelligence occasioned lethal opposition, because nothing is as dangerous as a black person with a brain, right? So that's why they're trying to ban books. First, they told us, if you want to hide something from a Negro, put it in a book. They didn't say to us, that's because you outlawed literacy. Now you're trying to tell us not to read books. Frederick Douglass said, no greater penalty was assigned during enslavement more than black enslaved people oversleeping. Now we woke, and you got a problem. The question is, why are white folks somnambulists? Why are they addicted to sleep? Because they don't want us to wake up. Because when we wake up, they are afraid that we might treat them like you done treated us. But that ain't us. Don't nobody love white folk more than Negroes. So, what we got to understand is that when they ban books, they're banning books for black people too. We don't even know our own history. We don't even study our own history. We don't even appropriate our own history. Plagiarize them? You saying you plagiarized our culture. You plagiarized our work, our labor. I bet Sally Hemings wrote the Declaration of Independence. Okay, she didn't. She was 3 years old, but I'm just saying. That's another problem. I don't see nothing wrong. But what's interesting then, is that what we have to do is not internalize the lie. James Baldwin said, my father was hurt and grieved because he believed the lie of white supremacy. What you must understand, you come from a great history. You are America. America would be nothing without us. Black history is American history. Black struggle is American struggle. Black intelligence is American intelligence. That's what we got to remind ourselves of.
Thanks so much, Dr. Dyson.
Bless you, Dr.
I want to ask Ms. Rule about how this issue is being covered in the media and what we can do or what the media should do in order to raise this issue in a broader way. So,
before I answer, I actually have a question for Professor Dr. Dyson. It goes to college admissions and affirmative action. When we think about our most elite universities in this country, mm-hmm. they have endowments in the many hundreds and hundreds of millions.
And billions.
And we mm-hmm. look at whether it's Columbia University or Vanderbilt University, their admittance rates are less than 10%. In this idea that, well, we can't possibly do this, people don't want to give up their seat at the table. These schools are in the ultimate positions of privilege.
Right.
Why can't they simply build bigger tables? Why can't they simply admit another 500 students a year and we don't have to, like, I'm not being sassy. It's a genuine question.
Amen, number one. I told you Stephanie got rules. And if we had Stephanie's rules, that would be great. But here's the point. The brilliance of that point, of course, is that they can expand the table at will. There is no arbitrary imposition of a limit to which they cannot descend or ascend. That's number one, so it's great. Number two, though, when we talk about expanding that, we know a lot more white folk gonna get in with the expansion too, because they were not denied because another black person got in. They were in competition not with African-American people, but with some Asian brothers and sisters that they want to change the rules for now that their competition is swamping them. Number three, you're absolutely right in this sense. If we make the argument that there is no limit on those resources, ultimately, because when you think about it, what? Some of these universities have $9 and $10 billion endowments. $1 billion endowments. And if we expand the opportunity gap, if we close the opportunity gap and expand the ability to draw upon more resources, it is true. We would have a greater representation of what it looks like to be an American society, which means that African-American people, Latinx people, that indigenous folk, that women and people of color all together would have a greater opportunity. But the problem is the same problem that keeps it limited now. It's the inability of the vast majority of white brothers and sisters to identify with those who are locked out. They see themselves in opposition to the black person who took my job, who took my space in school. What they won't understand is the necessity for solidarity so that everybody benefits. What you're saying makes too much sense. All of us could benefit. Their kids would get a greater access, our kids would greater access. But they want to say, nope, it's all for my kids. My kids earned it. Let me tell you, and I'll end by saying this. I teach at these white schools. Let me tell you, ain't no white superiority nowhere up in that place. So, what we have to be honest about is there are a few geniuses, some really smart, most average, and some dummies. That's for every race group in America. And if we could expand that table, more of us would get access.
Okay.
So that's impossible to follow with anything meaningful. That's brilliant. But I want to say, you know, Stephanie, the reason they don't do it is also because they're hedge funds. Their point is not to educate anyone. Their point is to hold that endowment and to generate money for Wall Street and others in managing that money. 75 to 80% of the students rejected from Vanderbilt are qualified to be admitted. So they're just picking people. So what these fights are about is making sure that, wait for it, the same people from Wall Street who are giving donations to these schools to get tax breaks, put their kids into the pool, and then they say, don't expand the pool, and then we've given a donation, so my kid, like Bill Ackman's kid and Bill Ackman himself, who are legacies, get to the head of the line, and we can all stand around at some party and say, I went to Harvard, and I remember being in the speed club, and we used to drink there every night, and now I'm gonna go into Goldman, and do, like, that's what it's about. It's not about educating anybody, right? Despite the fact that we kill it as educators there, it's not about educating.
Hell of a point, hell of a point, hell of a point, hell of a point. Hell of a point.
So I would say on the media front, I think something we all have to be is more honest, more practical. I'm going to say this for a second, more forgiving and more brave in what we talk about. Because I think there's a lot of heated topics that don't get covered by the media because the media is afraid to do it. Because maybe people in this room, when I walked in, thought, why is this rich white lady who has the most privileged white Ivy League husband sitting at this table? And I think that sometimes the media and voices that aren't the people at risk have to become allies and talk about these things. But I also think that Democrats need to be more practical and sometimes not be so sensitive.
Yes, ma'am.
Sometimes I think that Democrats are so careful,
yes, ma'am,
about talking about things, they're ruining their own game. They won't, yep, sing happy birthday until every kid in America has a cupcake. And that's a huge mistake, because if they don't start speaking truths or running victory laps where they should, they're gonna lose it all, yeah, right? The economy is a great example of, the Democrats hate to talk about a winning economy, and because they're afraid that there are some people who are left out, and that's true. But because they don't talk about the winning economy, that leaves way for Republicans to convince the American people we're the only ones who are good for the economy, not the Democrats. And if Democrats don't start playing their game and running those victory laps, then Democrats are gonna lose elections, and then the economically vulnerable people that Democrats are the most worried about are gonna lose the most, because all the social programs that they're dependent on are gonna get cut by Republicans. So when it comes to the media, we need to have more difficult and more practical conversations. And I think we have to take some blows and be a little more open-minded. But if you have people on television that you respect and they respect you, even if you come from different backgrounds, even if you have different views, if you come from a place of decency with the common goal, how do we make the world better and smarter? We're all gonna do better. But we've gotta be brave and bold in doing that.
Can I just say this very quickly? Wait a minute. So white people, when you talk about, we agree with you, but the most snowflakey people in the world who can't take the truth are rich white people. Look, let me give you an example. Don Lemon had a show on X. Elon Musk, who bitches about it, you can't take the truth, you can't handle it. Y'all a bunch of snowflakes, you're cookies, you're people who are incapable of absorbing opposition. Broke down because Don Lemon asked him a few questions and he canceled his show. That's it in a nutshell. So we need allies who are not full of all lies. We need allies, as Ms. Rule said, who can tell the truth to other white people. I need Stephanie Rule to speak white folk to white folk so they can understand what the hell is that we're up against and translate that for us. That's courage. That's standing up on your principles. Because I'm gonna tell you what, if more Republicans weren't racist, a lot more black people would be Republican. We're reactionary, we are conservative, we're homophobic, we're transphobic, we are made for the Republican Party, but you hate niggas.
So let's talk about And the next. All right. And the last minute or two that we have, I'm hopeful that we can talk about specific outcomes that everyone can take leaving here. And I want to start with Professor Crenshaw, because I know there's an event May 3rd. I know that there's resource materials that her team has brought, and I want her to share that.
All right. Well, AAPF, African American Policy Forum, has been all about trying to create those allies who speak the truth, all about trying to talk about how to talk about the things people don't want to talk about, which is race, how to talk about why we have so many book bans. What we've been doing for the last 2 years is going all around the country and passing out the books that they don't want us to have, passing out the information they don't want us to learn, passing out the language that they don't want us to have access to. But we've got to do more than just pass out books. We've got to get organized, mobilized, and we've got to show our strength all over the country. I always meet people who are outraged about the book bans, outraged about the attacks on anti-racism, outraged about the attacks on 1619, but when I ask them what they're doing about it, they might be tweeting, you know, they might post something, but they're not organized to do something about it. So part of why I'm so excited to be here is NAN is the one organization that is organizing to do something about this stuff. So that is changing the equation on the ground. So we've been calling for the last 2 years for a day, May 3rd, to be that day that we demonstrate that there are those all around the country who are unwilling to accept being sent back to where we've come from. So what we're trying to do on May 3rd is to have multiple activations all across the country, whether it's reading The Bluest Eye, the second most banned book. Toni Morrison is the second most banned author. The brilliant Toni Morrison, what does that tell us about what they're trying to take away from us? So you can read a banned book, you can go to a teach-in, you can join us in protesting the Heritage Foundation that is trying to pursue 2025. You can do any number of things. The most important thing is to do something and to post it, tell somebody, so that it creates a cacophony of sound all around the country of people refusing to go back. And let that be the first day of Freedom Summer 2024. Y'all know this is the 60th anniversary of Freedom Summer, which turned around the civil rights movement. It was a moment when young people came together to learn to teach our history, because we can't exist as a democracy if people don't understand what our situation is. We're hoping that this summer, Freedom Summer 2024, is where we draw the line in the sand, where we push back, where we do what we've always done. We say this democracy, but after that, we want something more. We want a real democracy where our votes really count, where people are gonna stand up and recognize that the whole thing about January 6th was about we were the ones that chose the White House. It was about Pennsylvania, it was about Philadelphia, it was about Detroit. That's what that was about. And if people aren't naming why our democracy is on life support, if they're not saying it's because of the diminished overrepresentation of white people, if they're not saying it's because we exercised our right to vote, if they're not telling the truth about it, then we're not going to be able to save it. We cannot save our democracy and leave anti-racism by the side of the road. The two have to come together. May 3rd is the opportunity for us to say that, and join us every Thursday night at 8 p.m. on Zoom for what we call a revival. So
thank you so much.
Check us out at aapf.org.
And on the third floor upstairs, there is a resource room, and Professor Crenshaw has materials and information, so I would urge you to check it out. Didn't you all enjoy this panel? Let's give them a round of applause.
Give the panel another hand. Hold it 1 minute. Before we take the group picture, I want you to know, you know, a lot of press is watching today because the president's going to address us in a couple of hours. So the press news flash that came out a few minutes ago says that Dyson wants the weed that white kids smoke at in his town. And he also revealed that Stephanie has rules. And we're waiting to see if Nan will denounce him using the N-word. Let's take the picture. You want us down there? Are we going to organize for May 3rd?
Yes.
Are we going to organize for May 3rd?
Yes.
I promised Kimberly Crenshaw, if she came, we would turn out May 3rd all over the country. I want our chapters working on May 3rd. All right, let's take our seats. Where? Where? Dominique? I don't see. Who is she? If it was in the folder, I wouldn't ask for it. This is all lunch. I know I'm right. It's not there. All right, let us settle down. Thank you, Stephanie Rule. Four people. too. All right, let us settle. One of the things that we have been very, very concerned about is environmental justice. Yes, sir. Too many of us ignore the fact that many of our communities are closest to the toxic dumps, that we receive the worst in the environment. We're glad to have the administrator of the Environmental Protection Agencies with us this morning, and he's going to have a fireside chat with me in a few minutes. I met with him, and he's been on my television show. I've talked with him, and he has been committed more than any EPA director I've known to dealing with the issue of environmental racism and safety for all Americans. Let's welcome to the stage the EPA Administrator, Michael S. Regan. Administrator Regan, thank you for being here. And let me give a little background. He's from Goldsboro, North Carolina. And we have North Carolina chapters here, as you can hear. He served as Secretary of the North Carolina Department of Environmental Quality. And since the start of his career, he's remained steadfast in his commitment to protecting and advancing environmental justice. Now, Administrator Regan, I know that you grew up in North Carolina exploring the outdoors with your family, and I know that both your parents were public service. And I know you are a graduate of North Carolina A&T State University.
Aggie Pride.
Could you please share more about your background that led you to this path?
Well, thank you, Reverend Sharpton, for having me, and it's good to be here. As you said, you know, I did not have to really search for my heroes. My parents were there every single day. My mother was a nurse for about 40 years before she retired. Service in our community and had seen it all from cancer to respiratory illnesses, gunshot wounds, mental illness. So that public health piece was there when I was growing up. My father was a Vietnam veteran, agricultural extension agent. And I spent a lot of time outdoors hunting and fishing with my father and my grandfather. And so it was a perfect merger there of natural resource protection and public health. And pursued my undergraduate degree at North Carolina A&T State University in environmental science. But I also got that nurturing at that HBCU. And, you know, my first job was an internship at EPA. So I've always had this glide path focused on natural resource protection and public health, but also knew that our people, our folks, are disproportionately impacted by pollution and environmental injustice. So for me to get the call from President Biden to come back to this agency and lead this agency at this time is just one of the greatest honors.
As you came back in and answered the call of President Biden to head it up, what did you find in terms of environmental inequality and that you had to tackle? What did you find, and then what are we trying to do about it?
Well, you know, what I found coming into office after the Trump administration was an agency that was almost decimated. The previous administration had underfunded, moved away from science, and moved away from some of the environmental justice programs that were there before I got there.
Now, when you say underfunded, just so the audience is clear, you're saying that the whole agency was underfunded?
Absolutely.
So it wasn't just the equality part. The Trump administration didn't care a lot about the environmental concerns for even some of their folks.
That's right. The resources to invest in science, following the law, giving our career people the ability. First of all, let me take a step back and say that my agency is responsible for providing clean air and clean water to every single person in this country. And so the previous administration, thank you, yes. We're also at the tip of the spear to reduce pollution that exacerbates climate change. And so what I found was an agency that had been demoralized by the previous political folks that had been there. And as the Reverend is alluding to, 4 years of an attempt to undermine the funding of the very agency responsible for providing clean air and clean water. And as you all can imagine, those who were hurt the worst and the most significant are our Black and brown and tribal and low-income communities. It was surgical. It was very tough. And so President Biden essentially said, we have to go back in and make this agency all that it can be. And we're gonna start by making sure that those who are disproportionately impacted, those who have not had a seat at the table, are the first ones in line. And I'll say this, I am very proud to work for President Biden. He's the first sitting president, now twice, to talk about environmental justice during the State of the Union, talking to the entire country. So there's a very strong commitment, Reverend. When I say I am committed to environmental justice, that is because the remit is coming from the President of the United States, and I believe we've been doing that the last 3.5 years.
Now, when we talk about environmental justice, particularly to Black people and other people of color, it might not be at the top of the list of concerns, but it is a major concern. Everything we do is in the environment. And a lot of what we suffer from is based on just environmental infrastructure and other things that we operate in and never pay attention to. How do you pinpoint that to say to Black and brown people how important it is that we do the work around environment?
The first thing I would say is environmental justice, civil rights, economic justice, closing the gap on health disparities, they're inseparable. They are intrinsically connected, and so we shouldn't pull that apart. When you, take a look at Jackson, Mississippi, and the water crisis that entire city is facing, you look at the systemic disproportionate impact to those communities, that is not a coincidence. I will say this. When I took this role, I created a Journey to Justice tour, and I invited MSNBC and CNN and the influence to follow me through the South, through the Black Belt, so that people could understand what's happening in 2021. And when you go to places like Lowndes County, Alabama, and 30% of the population has or had hookworm, most people think that that's a third world issue, and it's not. That's happening right here
30%.
In this country. 30% in 2021.
In Lowndes County, Alabama.
Lowndes County, Alabama.
Wow.
I toured Louisiana, went through all the parishes. I think most of you know that part of the country we refer to as Cancer Alley. And, I've met with individuals whose parents, whose sisters, whose children and grandchildren, multiple generations in the same household, different cancers. These things are not by coincidence. And so when we talk about environmental injustice, these are the things that the president has tasked me to focus on. And let me talk about, Cancer Alley for just 1 second, because I took a tour of Cancer Alley 2 years ago, and it changed my life. Meeting with and talking with and walking down the streets with people who have multiple generations of cancer in their family, living a stone's throw away from petrochemical facilities that have moved in on their communities that have been there post-slavery. Just a couple of days ago this week, EPA announced a regulation that would reduce that pollution by 80%. And the thing about it is for that community, for those people living in that community, we're gonna reduce the cancer risk for those communities by 96%. This is what government can do. So when we talk about environmental justice, there's that health component. But in this same community, there was an elementary school where children the same age as my son Matthew, 10, are learning and playing and spending time with their friends, and 1,000, 2,000 feet away is a chemical facility, so you know what those kids are inhaling while they're trying to learn. So it impacts education, it impacts health, it lowers the value of our properties, it reduces the opportunities for economic development in our communities. So when we talk about environmental justice, we're talking about economic justice, health justice, we're talking about civil rights.
Now, in the past few years, you talked about the Biden-Harris administration, and it passed the bipartisan infrastructure law. It passed the Inflation Reduction Act, delivering historic investments into the nation's infrastructure. Talk to me about how EPA is using this unprecedented funding to invest in American communities, particularly Black and brown communities.
Well, thank you for that question, Reverend. The agency that I run is typically about a $10 billion a year agency focused on protecting our air and our water. But because the president partnered with Congress, there are two pieces of historic legislation that gave EPA more than $100 billion to focus on clean air and clean water. With that additional resources, we have prioritized Black and brown, tribal, and low-income communities in terms of getting those investments first. So when you talk about $50 billion to invest in water infrastructure, you begin to close the gap and level the playing field for cities like Jackson, Mississippi. Working with the president and Congress, we got Jackson about $800 million to invest in drinking water. And what we're doing is we're going all across the country. We've designed metrics, we've designed programs so that the bulk of this money, at least 40%, but that's the floor, in some cases at EPA, 60 and 70% of these investments are going into Black and brown and low-income communities. It's not just an investment in infrastructure, but we've also got the metrics and the requirements in place so that there are training programs, job development programs, and economic development opportunities for minority-owned businesses as well. So we're talking about investing in the very fabric of our communities. And I know we throw around a lot of money, but I will say, folks, $100 billion with 50, 60, 70% of that going to minority-owned businesses, minority communities, communities of color, low-income communities. We need to tell this story because this is the kind of work that President Biden is doing all across this country.
Explain what the Greenhouse Gas Reduction Fund does.
Well, you know, what the Greenhouse Gas Reduction Fund essentially does, it's a green bank. Congress saw fit to give my agency $27 billion to invest in low carbon technologies, technologies that would reduce pollution. What I said and what Congress said and my staff said is, we could take this $27 billion and invest it, but we need to work with people who know how to leverage capital. So we created a grant competition, and we just awarded 8 different national nonprofits that $20 billion to invest in minority, predominantly minority communities. Yes.
How much was that?
It's $20 billion.
Mm-hmm.
$6 billion of the 20 is going directly to CDFIs because we know our community development financial institutions have always been investing in our communities, so they know how to use that money. The other $14 billion is going to national nonprofits that specialize in investing in affordable housing, efficient housing, and community development. Now, the exciting thing about this, and I spend a lot of time with folks in the banking, the financial, Wall Street, we estimate that this $20 billion will pull hundreds of billions of dollars of private capital off the sidelines. And I want to just give one brief story to tell you what that really means. I was in Charlotte, North Carolina with the vice president about 2 weeks ago. And we spent time in a gentleman's home who lived in a historically Black community that was going through redevelopment. One of these CDFIs was redeveloping these homes, ensuring that they were affordable and that they would stave off gentrification. The house that he was living in had efficient appliances, sealed, weatherized. The home he lived in before, his power bill, his electric bill, was about $600 a month. The home he's living in now, his power bill is about $125 a month. What he said to me was, with that reduction, he has two sons. Every month now, $50 a piece is going into their savings account. Another couple of $100 is being reinvested in his business. This is what we're talking about when we say a greenhouse gas reduction fund. Most people focus on the climate and the pollution, but there's also the financial opportunity to get people in clean, affordable housing to improve the quality of their life.
You recently went on a tour of Africa, and I believe Derek Johnson, who has been here the last couple of days, head of the NAACP, went with you. Tell us about the tour, the reason, and what you found.
You know, President Johnson and I have worked on a lot of challenging issues domestically, like Jackson, the water crisis there. And, you know, we decided that in addition to what we're doing here domestically, the president challenged us to take this leadership to the global stage. But he also challenged the entire cabinet to reinvest in our relationship with the continent of Africa. So Derek and I decided to visit two countries, Mozambique and Ghana. Yes. And in Ghana, EPA has had a long-standing relationship with that country because primarily from a cooking and providing nutrition standpoint, the women are the ones that are in charge. And while they're cooking and changing out the wood stoves and performing that task of providing nutrition, they typically have their children strapped to their backs. And a lot of those children are young girls. So we were seeing a disproportionate impact in pollution from those stoves impacting women and young girls. So we've been having, we have a cook stove change-out program. We want to accelerate that program so that women in Africa have a more competitive opportunity to provide that nutrition, but also not at the expense of their health so they can do other things as well. Yes. But from a national security standpoint, we also know that China and other countries like Russia are going over to Africa and they're exploiting their natural resources. And so what Derek and I were looking at were opportunities to provide technical assistance so that their natural resources aren't exploited, especially at the expense of their people. We could provide technical assistance to help with public health and other opportunities as well. And then there's a lot of economic development opportunities. So it's great from a national security standpoint to have friends in Mozambique and Ghana. It's awesome for us to share technical assistance for our sisters who are there just trying to live their lives and provide for their families. And we are also looking at ways that we can preserve the beauty of these countries so that they're not exploited by countries like China and Russia and others who want to take their minerals.
In the next few months, leading into the next election and on, what are the priorities that you and EPA has that relates directly to a lot of our delegates and chapter leaders of NAN in terms of the communities we serve in?
Yeah, and what I'll say is, in a way that I don't violate the Hatch Act, is I know that you know, the next election is upon us. But
I'm not saying you're doing it for the election.
Right.
I'm just giving a time frame. Has nothing to do with your campaign. Is that you know you'll be there at least till the next election?
That's, yes, sir.
I'm using it for time, not for politics. You're right about the Hatch Act. I'm sorry.
With that time, that.
But I'm not under the Hatch Act. But go ahead.
You know, we have a sense of urgency. I've had a sense of urgency from day one. And so over the next coming months, to your point, Reverend, we know we have a guaranteed time frame at least 6 to 8 months from now. So there are some regulations that we're absolutely going to put in place to continue to reduce pollution that disproportionately impact our communities. But I want you all to hear me very carefully, and I want you to go to epa.gov and look at these resources, because over the past couple of years and the next couple of months, we have to get these billions of dollars out of EPA and into our communities. So we need for your organizations to apply for these grants. We need for your organizations to let folks know that there are ways for public-private partnership so we can develop our businesses as well. So there's a short runway that is guaranteed that if we work together and if we arm ourselves with knowledge and education about those resources we have, we can create a lot of economic development and we can improve the health of our communities. And that's something that we all have to work on together.
All right, give a big hand, Michael Regan, EPA Administrator.
Thank you all.
I listened as a lot of our speakers spoke, and many say amen, but when you said we can apply for grants, I heard three big amens over here. All right, thank you for being here with us. Give him another hand. How do we empower ourselves online? How do we teach our community not to run from technology, but use it properly? Reverend Steffi Bartley, who has built NAN Newark Tech, has a panel. We're going to do that for a few minutes, and then we're going to deal with our international issues and to hear from the President of the United States. Reverend Steffi Bartley, founder of NAN Tech World.
Thank you, Reverend Sharpton. Let's give our leader another hand. Isn't he outstanding? What a great leader. What a great leader. I'm so happy to be a part of the National Action Network and all the great things that we're doing and the impact that we're making on our community. I think it's so vitally important that we make sure that we're involved with everything. And as you've been seeing, those of you that have been here since the beginning, we understand that nothing happens without the National Action Network. So can you give yourselves a hand? Nah, y'all didn't really clap. How do you not clap for yourself? If no one appreciates me, I know how to appreciate myself. And so let's try that one more time. Can you give yourselves a hand? As many of you know, I also pastor in the city of Elizabeth, New Jersey, at New Hope Memorial, where we call the Hope Church. And I'm so honored to have my right hand with me, my wife, Lady Harriet Bartley. Can you give her a hand? We're going to get ready now. We're waiting on our panelists to come. And so I'm going to try to get some of this out of the way so when they arrive that we can get right into this, because we know we only have a few moments because we're moving so expeditiously in what we're doing today. And so I want to welcome everyone to our panel today to discuss empowering Black voices, Black people online. And today's digital age, we want to make sure that we are ensuring the safety online space for Black communities. Why? Because it's so crucially and so vitally important that we are aware and that we are a part of the digital divide. And to make sure that we have access like everyone else. And so we're here today with our esteemed panel, and they're going to shed light on various aspects of these topics. And so we're going to be waiting. I hope some of our panelists are here waiting, and they're going to come, and we're going to dive right into this digital divide. And so can we have those, everyone's here? So can you all give our panelists a hand as they're coming? Wow. As they would say, any day now, any day now. Here they come. Would you give them another hand? Wow. Ladies, how are you? Good to see you. Oh, hello. This is the greatest panel here. This is the greatest. Wow. You don't have a name tag? Sit right here, because Sean will not be with us today. He's a little under the weather, and we want Sean to know that we're praying for him. We're sure that he's watching, that we're praying for him, and we want him to know that he's in our prayers. And so what I would like to do, I would like to dive right into this, and we'll make it so much easier so that Pastor Bartley does not mess up anyone's name. I would like for them briefly just to introduce themselves and who they are represented, starting from my left.
Thank you. Am I on?
Yes.
I am so honored to be here. I am Narda Jones. I am the Chief of Staff at the Federal Communications Commission.
Hello, everyone. Happy to be here. I'm Nicole Lazar, VP of Policy and External Affairs at Charter Communications. Very happy to be with you all and to be joining this panel.
I'm Anissa Green with AT&T Federal Regulatory Team in DC.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Michelle Kober. I am on the Public Policy and External Affairs team for Verizon in Washington, D.C.
And hello, everyone. My name is Roy Austin. I'm the Vice President of Civil Rights and Deputy General Counsel at Meta.
Let's dive right into this. And so here's what I've been told. I would like to share this with you all today. We hear about the data, the breaches every day from apps you may use on your phone to the banks or to the stores being hacked. This data, this privacy, it refers to the protection of personal information stored and transmitted through electronic devices, ensuring the unauthorized access, use or disclose does not occur. This includes safeguarding sensitive data such as personal identifiers, financial information, communication records from unauthorized access or misuse. In recent surveys, most U.S. consumers have expressed increasingly concerns their data privacy. It is said that 73% are more worried about data privacy now than in previous years. 64% feel their data is less secure today compared to before. 67% believe government should play a larger role in safeguarding one's privacy. And so given how much our lives are now online. Everything we do is online. Everything we do is access internet. From work, home, to school, phone, to pocket, all of these devices. What is the FCC doing to protect consumer data and privacy? Yes.
I think that's for me.
Yes.
You did such a good job of outlining the risks and the way that technology today is intertwined with every aspect of our lives and our cell phones. We are all attached to them. We carry them with us, and in doing so, we're providing a lot of information to with regard to our location, with regard to our activity,
Speak right in the mic. Thank you.
Better?
Yes.
All right. I'll start over. I was just saying how the very fact that we carry our phones around provides a lot of information. And that information is critical with regard to our data privacy. And what the FCC is doing has a lot to do with our authority over regulating cell phones and regulating our data breaches. And we have rechartered a data privacy group We are using tools around enforcement and around consumer education. So we let consumers know about what their options are when their data has been breached. We are going after carriers and data brokers with the authority we have to enforce our rules to make sure that when our data gets out there and is misused, that we have taken actions appropriate to protect consumers. We are engaging with consumers and sharing tools that you can use to protect your data. And we're always open to hearing from our colleagues and our stakeholders about new technologies and intersections that allow us to further protect consumers.
Wow. Now let's do this. Let's move next. Let's go into a pivotal talk that we really need to talk about, and that is our youth. Our youth awareness online. We know that social media can both provide valuable support and at the same time, they could present challenges to our youth. Many parents and guardians are forced to make sure that our youth online for our young is being safely guarded. It is so vitally important when we see all of our youth online, and we need to make sure we know exactly what they're online engaging in, because so many things could happen. And so here we are, we're going to ask Roy you this question, Roy. What tools and resources do your company provide to offer families to help them navigate their teens' online experiences?
So thank you, first of all, for having me on this panel. Thank you to Reverend Sharpton. Thank you to Ebony. Thank you for all of you who are here today. So at Meta, if you are under 13, you are not supposed to be using Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp, or what's not. You're not supposed to be on those things. And so it is we need parents to help us keep youth off of them, and we're going to do our job to keep youth off of our devices, and so are off of our platforms. So with respect to parents, we have something called the Family Center. If you go to the Family Center when you're setting up your, when your child is going online, you can know exactly who is following them, and you can know exactly what sites they're following or what they're following off of our platform. So it's incredibly important that parents play an active role in ensuring that their young people are not going places where they shouldn't be. At the same time, we at Meta do a ton to try to keep youth off of the platform, underage youth, but also to protect youth who are of age. So to prevent underage youth, we prevent them from coming on, certainly if we know that they are under 13. If we find out or get information that they are under 13, we do what we can to remove them from the platform. If they're over 13, to protect them, first of all of the privacy settings or all of the settings are set automatically to private if you are between 13 and 16, so you're not out there in the public. And if we know that you are underage, underage being under 16, we're going to make sure that adults can't follow you. We're going to make sure that even if you put a comment on someone's post, that they can't then follow you there. But what's really important is that you, as parents, know what your child is following, and we've given you the tools. There are over 50 tools at Meta on our platforms to help parents keep their children from getting into trouble on our platforms.
So Roy, so when you say that, that the parents and the guardians can go to a website to find those 50 different advices to give to them, so that way they do not get themselves in trouble with their teens, because you know we have that problem when you try today to tell teens they need to do this, they need to do that, and then sometimes when we know as black and brown how to discipline them, they don't get it. And so how do we keep the parents and the guardians out of trouble? So that advice, they could find it online?
Yeah, so it's called the Family Center. If you look up the Family Center, and what it does is when you're setting it up, you can make sure that you will know what your child, who your child is following and who's following your child. And that's incredibly important. And so you will have that information. You don't have to go up to them and ask them, oh, who are you following, or give me your phone or anything like that. When you set it up, you can have that kind of control and information that you need to help to protect your child online.
Let's give Roy a hand for that. We need that. Here's a question for everyone. In what ways does your company engage with Black youth to promote digital literacy and provide an opportunity for skill development in technology? We'll start with you. Nicole.
So in terms of digital
speaking
literacy,
to the mic, Nicole.
I'm sorry, okay.
Thank you.
So you're asking in what ways our company works directly with youth in order to promote digital literacy
funds? Yes.
So for us as a company, we're very invested in promoting digital equity, digital inclusion, and digital adoption. And so a lot of our efforts center around, first of all, basically making the internet affordable through various programs, including our Spectrum Internet Assist, and including programs that we have that work with schools and libraries and districts throughout the nation to help them provide bulk services and enterprise services so that they can provide their students with access to the internet. We also support a number of community organizations. We have a number of community solutions where we provide philanthropic assistance to community centers and invest in jobs training programs and other digital skill and digital literacy centers to help them modernize, to help them get up to speed. Currently, we have a $30 million initiative that's invested in about 40 community centers throughout the United States. And we have a number of new community centers, about 100, that we will invest in over a five-year period. As I mentioned, affordability is an important part of getting youth online, addressing the homework gap, as some call it. And so we were pleased to participate in programs like the Affordable Connectivity Program, which helped millions connect and stay connected to internet services and the many opportunities it provides for education, for healthcare, for remote work, for job training. So we have a number of initiatives where we help youth get online.
Nadia?
Yeah, I want to support everything that Nicole said. The ACP program, which Nicole's company and the other companies participate in, has been a game changer in terms of getting youth online. 23 million families got to benefit from that program, which unfortunately is, unless Congress acts, will be sunsetting in a few weeks here. But through that program, we've been able to address the homework gap that Nicole referenced by making the connections for students affordable so that whether you're on tribal lands or in a remote area or in the city, you can actually get an affordable connection to do your homework, get online to search for jobs, participate in civic activities, keep up with family. It has been the largest program of its kind ever, and we're really proud of it. And we're really grateful for the partnership that the companies like Nicole's and Michelle's and Anissa's has joined with us to execute on this program.
Yeah, at AT&T, we are dedicated to providing reliable and affordable connectivity. Just last week, we announced our further commitment to closing the digital divide and putting our money where our mouths are. We put another $3 billion into that effort. We have a very aggressive plan to get another, I think it's 25 million people connected by 2030. And in addition to getting families connected, we know that the online world can be a little scary space. And sharing some of what Roy had advised for parents to think about and get educated on, as a parent myself, I highly encourage you to see all those tools. There's many tools in addition to Meta's, even with your own service provider, I'm sure there's tools that you can protect your